And welcome to the 19th meeting in 2024 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. We have apologies today from Ross Greer, and in his stead we have Patrick Harvey. Do you have any declarations to make, Patrick?
No relevant interest to declare.
Thank you very much for that. Today we continue to give evidence in relation to our inquiry into Scotland's Commission on Landscape from the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body. The SPCB. We are joined by Maggie Chapman, MSP, SPCB Lead on Business Support and Office Holders, Jackson Carlaw, MSP, SPCB Lead on Finance and Organisational Governance. Impressed with these titles, I have to say. David McGill, Clerk, Chief Executive of the Scottish Parliament. I'd like to wish you all good morning and welcome you to the meeting. And as San Maggie wishes to make a short opening statement.
Yes, I'll be very brief, but firstly just to say thank you to the committee for inviting us to give evidence as part of your inquiry into the Scotland's Commissioner Landscape. As you are aware, the corporate body currently supports 7 office holders and funds the devolved Scottish activities of the Electoral Commission. We also will support the new Patient Safety Commissioner for Scotland when they are appointed and their office is established. As you know, we have raised concerns with this committee before and also with Scottish ministers about the growing number of commissioners and the impact that this has on the corporate body's workload, overall budget and staff. We also know that quite a lot of the responsibilities that we have are reactive and responsive to decisions made by this Parliament. So we are therefore grateful to contribute to this inquiry, contribute to your work and look forward to the discussion with you this morning. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. We've taken extensive evidence on this already, which I'm sure you're well aware of, but I'm quite keen to get the SPCB's view on this because you're obviously very key to this whole discussion. I mean, one of the things I would ask first of all is whether you know you would agree that the proposals to establish commissioners are driven by a kind of perception of systemic failure and malfunctions in the system. And if that's the case, does the SPCB have any view at all on whether there are other ways in which these systemic fails could be addressed other than by the establishment of commissioners?
So I think given the commissioners that we currently support and the proposals that we see coming forward, either those that have already been enacted or those that are in the pipeline, I think there are a variety of reasons that campaign groups, individuals, organisations seek to establish commissioners. And some of those elements do stem from systemic failure, I think, a recognition that maybe people's rights aren't being realised or respected, or there are fundamental issues with how people are being treated, particularly, for example, in the justice and health sectors. We've referenced the Patient Safety Commissioner already, but we're also aware of the Victims Commissioner in legislation currently going through Parliament. So those systemic failures are issues for this Parliament and for the Scottish Government to address. And I think people often think that commissioners can provide that independent and separate view as an advocate, as a champion, and as a mechanism to remedy for some of those systemic failures. So I don't know if Jackson or David want to comment any further.
I think I would say, Convener, that in terms of the growth in advocacy commissioners, what is the genesis of that? Well, it used to be that elected representatives called for a royal commission. Then elected representatives called for a summit on the particular issue that was of great concern for them. Then they said it would be useful if the government appointed a czar who would have a responsibility for these issues. And now they say it would be useful if there was a commissioner appointed to represent these views. And each stage of that has, I think, been seen as a panacea for greater accountability, but has been succeeded by another level of request, because actually it wasn't. And I was very struck by Professor Alan Page in his evidence to you last week when he said, my MSP is my commissioner. And in terms of advocacy, I actually think that is what MSPs were elected to be. And it's difficult, looking at the landscape of advocacy commissioners, to deny why you would say you can't now have an animal rights commissioner or a commissioner for the Scottish language or a commissioner for veterans or a commissioner for the incorporation of science into society. It is attractive to elected representatives to begin a campaign in an unstructured landscape And the current architecture by which these things are judged by Parliament doesn't put any obstacle in the way of that proposal simply finding its way through the parliamentary system. And I therefore, you know, think that A, there has to be a greater understanding of what a commissioner should be and if there is a genuine reason for one to exist. Secondly, I think MSPs are there to be the advocates for many of these things. And if we're failing in our duty, and after all, that's why this Parliament was set up, to be advocates on all of these issues, then that is a question for us.
I'll have to say I couldn't agree with you more, actually. But in terms of obstacles, what kind of obstacle would you think we'd be able to put in the kind of way of the development of myriad individual commissioners coming out over the next 5 years or whatever?
I think there needs to be, I think, a general acceptance across the whole of Parliament on exactly those points that Jackson makes. What are commissioners for? Are they as a last resort? Are they there to provide a particular regulatory or scrutiny, independent regulatory functions? And I think there's the acceptance that some are and some are required. But these advocacy, these champion commissioners, I think there's a key question for Parliament as a whole to understand exactly what the issues are and whether there is an existing structure or an existing mechanism that would be a better route. We've seen, for example, an increase in rights-based asks, questions coming in, and you think, well, we have a national human rights institution within the Scottish Human Rights Commission. What is that not doing? What does it not have the powers to do? What does it not have the resources to do effectively and appropriately that is requiring or make people think that we require additional rights-based or rights-focused commissioners? So I think they're questions to be asked of existing structures, both within this place and within the existing commissioner landscape, but also of our public bodies more generally around their responsibilities and accountability. If accountability keeps coming back to Parliament and scrutiny is for our committees and for Parliament as a whole, are we actually doing that role effectively? So in terms of obstacles for the generation of new commissioners, I think there's a body of work across in this place that to help us all understand exactly what these bodies are for. And as your first question indicated, where are the systemic failures that people think commissioners are the answers to? And is that relationship, is that line of cause and effect the correct one, or are there existing bodies either within the scrutiny committees we have already or within public agencies that should be developing those lines of accountability and responsibility?
Okay, thank you. Now, when Jackson was talking about, you know, summits at Czars, etc., one thing you didn't talk about was, of course, the need for some MSPs to feel they should have a legacy. And it used to be members' bills. And I remember in the last few weeks of the last session, there were a number of colleagues who brought forward members' bills, and I was the one who volunteered on behalf of my party to say to some esteemed colleagues who were retiring, I don't actually think your bill's that great and should progress. I'm hoping someone else will take on that role in this session. But I think I'm making a serious point here, because we had a couple of former commissioners in private session who brought forward, for example, a victims and witnesses kind of commissioner proposal, and also an older people's proposal, who now are of the view that they should not progress, having looked at it from the outside. So I'm just wondering whether or not you feel that this, we're at the cusp now where we should be taking, as a Parliament, a decision that, for example, on advocacy, we should perhaps pull up the drawbridge and say, no, that really is an issue that should be addressed by ministers and the Parliament itself and individual MSPs, rather than expect someone else to kind of fill the gap that you talked about as a kind of almost like a cop-out from what we are, as MSPs, are supposed to be doing.
I think the first thing to say is there's my personal view and there's a view of the corporate body. Mm. The corporate body doesn't have an executive function in this regard. We are there to implement the will of Parliament as Indeed. Expressed. And I noticed a suggestion from the Deputy First Minister, for example, that we should potentially, as a corporate body, have a series of tests by which the establishment of a commissioner would be judged. That's not our responsibility. We don't have a party political function in the corporate body. That is the will of Parliament to express whether or not they want a commissioner. Our responsibility is to facilitate that commissioner. But I thought, again, Alan Page made a point which is absolutely directly to what you say, and that is the complete volte-face of the government. I served in 2008 in this Parliament on the committee that was established at the government's instigation to rationalise the number of commissioners we had at that point. I have to say it was very difficult because the recommendations that we actually made to rationalise commissioners, with all the support of colleagues as we did it, once they became public, well then the people who saw that their commissioner might be rationalised away started campaigns with MSPs who then got cold feet about all this idea of rationalising commissioners. So I think the problem is once they're there, they're very difficult to walk back from. But now the Scottish Government seems, as an instrument of policy, keen on the establishment of commissioners. And I think what's changed, therefore, is that the Parliament's never had an architecture by which this Parliament, MSPs, independently judge whether or not the establishment of a commissioner is a good thing. It simply is a proposal, a member's bill that goes through the committee system relevant to that bill without it being considered in a more general and rounded basis as to whether or not that adds or hinders the overall architecture. And so I think if the government is going to be keener on it, rather than the government being unenthusiastic, then Parliament itself, I think, has to consider whether it now should set up the architecture by which any of these proposals is judged before it even gets to the discussion in committee of what the particular powers of that individual might or might not be. And I think in that sense, we have to be a little bit keener on saying no to some of these things because, you know, I mean, David always tells me I'm in danger of exaggerating these things, but wearing the finance hat, I think it's about 12% of our budget now.
Yes, that's right.
And it could easily become 15% of our budget, 12% of our budget, or £18 million. £18 million we're spending on the current raft of commissioners. It's only going to get greater. And you've got to ask yourself, these people aren't elected. Are they being properly held to account? Was there a proper structured architecture by which they were appointed in the first place? And that's what I think we should be considering putting in place.
And if I can just add in on that, I think with the current proposals that are going through now, one of the questions that we've discussed, but again, it's not for us to dictate or mandate, is if a commissioner is proposed to deal with a particular systemic failure, should there be a sunset clause that limits the lifetime of that office? To deal with that specific issue and then. That's the end of it, because I think there's, as Jackson has said, you know, where is the ongoing accountability? Committees and Parliament, commissioners are accountable to Parliament and committees, but in terms of role expansion and role creation, if they are established to do a particular piece of work, how does that grow and expand and take on more responsibilities, and where is the accountability in that? Never mind the work they actually do, actually the overall role changes that happen over time.
This session's already generating so many questions, but I'm keen to let my colleagues in, so I'm not going to ask many more. But that point you've made is one that I actually brought up with SPCB some months ago myself about a sunset clause, because I've always thought that a commissioner comes in with a big head of steam and all the ideas, and you want to deliver this and you want to deliver that. And one would have thought that over a period of time, the bulk of what they were set up to achieve would either have been achieved or they would have hit a wall and they wouldn't have been able to take it forward. And it's always seemed to me bizarre that these commissioners, once established, seem to go on and on and on and on and on forever. And when we ask the commissioners themselves, says, oh no, it costs so much to set them up and all that kind of stuff, it's more value for money if we let them roll on kind of thing. So there's a kind of self-interest there, understandably. In terms of finance, incidentally, I don't think that they're happy about the 18.2 million. The ones that we had all think that they could spend a lot more than that if they were given the opportunity to. So, just so you know, when the next budget bid comes forward...
You will notice, Convener, that next year's budget, of course, increases the percentage by considerably more than any other headlined increase, because we will be having to fund an additional commissioner. And I would just caution on the sunset point that you make, though, in that that is what I rather thought the 2008 committee inquiry would achieve. But the problem, as I say, was when you get to the point of suggesting that a commissioner not be renewed or that it might fall, a very considerable lobby will be established on MSPs not to allow that heinous act of violence to be visited on this very valuable individual's work. And that is the obstacle that I think colleagues would face.
Indeed, I think we're aware of that. Okay, I just want to finish from myself in terms of the issue of scrutiny itself. I mean, from what I'm hearing, I don't think the SPCB is even particularly enthusiastic about having this kind of role. And it, certainly the evidence we've had is that there's a view that committees should be more widely involved in that. But I'm just wondering if you can take us through how you scrutinise these, because when we've taken evidence from the SPCB in the past, there's been talk of we'll only get like 1.5 people to fulfil that scrutiny function. And when we look at the depth of what some of the commissioners do and the breadth of it and the number of staff they've got and this and that, it just seemed to me as if they're perhaps not as scrutinised as well as it could be, although they all tell us that they're all scrutinised in a very robust way. So I'm just wondering if you can take us through, I don't, maybe David would be the best person to talk about that, I'm not really sure, but just to let us know.
Shall I kick off, and David, just to get an idea of what the
scrutiny means in terms of commissioners.
So for all commissioners, there's a written agreement between ourselves and the relevant committees that clearly outline the different roles and responsibilities that corporate body has compared to the subject committees in terms of scrutiny. It sets out a robust governance role for the corporate body itself, and supports the effective scrutiny of committees in their respective functions. So within the corporate body, we have responsibility for funding the various office holders, as you've already heard, and oversight of the governance arrangements. So establishing, you know, ensuring that they follow the appropriate practice around employment and around standards for being employers. So corporate body sets those conditions. Office holders are accountable to the Parliament for the functions that are laid out in legislation, and they do that through providing annual reports. And many committees will call office holders in on an annual basis for scrutiny sessions. So the corporate body's role is pretty discreet. It's around funding and it's setting up the governance arrangement. We appoint the accountable officer, for instance, in each of the commissioner or office holder responsibilities. We also receive their annual reports and we discuss with them their budget asks because of that funding and financial role that we have. But there is that separation between funding and governance and scrutiny and accountability of their functions. And corporate body does the funding and governance, committees do the functions of their role.
I say this as someone who's served in the corporate body since 2016. You ask if we're enthusiastic about the responsibility, and I think I'd probably say not particularly. Our first responsibility is actually to recruit the commissioners and recommend their appointment by Parliament. And I hope I'm not denigrating anyone when I say that you might be surprised that for quite a number of the positions for which we are required to make a recommendation, there have been very few applicants. So I would say that is also, to my mind, something of an issue. In addition, we appoint an independent assessor whose job it is to annually review the work of the commissioners and come back to us to be with in terms of their satisfaction with the execution of the governance function for which we are responsible. Until he retired, Hugh Williams, one of the Parliament's most experienced officials, along with Janice Creer, are dedicated to this area and meet with these commissioners regularly and discuss and try to identify where there are going to be organisational or operational problems, which would relate again to the governance aspect of their responsibility. And conscious of the fact that it is quite a big galaxy of commissioners we now have, we've nonetheless, as a corporate body, decided we need to carve out time, even if that means exceptional meetings of the corporate body, to ensure that we are meeting on a more structured and regular basis with each of the commissioners to understand exactly what it is they are doing and how they are going about it. But as Maggie has said, the responsibility thereafter is for the committees. And of course, that's not necessarily an even spread of accountable commissioners to the committees. And I appreciate, being a convener of a committee myself, that the responsibilities of the committee, never mind the responsibility for scrutinising a commissioner, are such that with legislation, with initiatives they may want to undertake in their own account, finding time to do this kind of like once a year must feel like a sort of brick in a bucket in terms of relevance to everything else that they've necessarily been doing. And I therefore wonder whether the genuine kind of underwriting of that scrutiny is taking place.
Thank you very much. Again, lots more questions to ask, but I'm going to open out the session to colleagues. First will be Liz, to be followed by Michelle.
Thank you. Can I just set out what I think the main challenge is? Namely, we have got some of our witnesses, quite a lot of our witnesses actually, but particularly those like Professor Page and Dr. Elliott last week, very intent that we should be thinking about completely overhauling the structure that we have for commissioners. But as Mr. Carlo has rightly said, we've got an issue about trying to remove existing commissioners, because it would be quite difficult to do that. So I just wonder if there is a slightly different argument between the existing commissioners that we have, plus the one for patient safety, who's obviously that's legislatively going to happen, or whether the argument is about how we proceed with the demands for new commissioners. Do you think there is a different focus there that we need to take?
I suppose I'm not sure that there's a shared corporate body view on that, but I suppose it depends how quickly we want to get to the point of that architecture, that structure within which these functions sit that Jackson was talking about. I think there probably is more difficulty in dealing with the commissioners that already exist. You know, the 2009 review found exactly that. Lots of work went into that review. Mm. Very clear recommendations with well-justified rationales, and Parliament decided not to do that. And I think it would be a very strange situation if the same resistance wasn't met now. I think with new and proposed commissioners, I think there is an opportunity for us to have conversations with the individuals, with the individual members who are maybe proposing them, with the campaign groups, and with the committees that will have responsibility for the functional scrutiny of those roles. I think actually is this the best option? What is the problem that is trying to be fixed here?
I mean, I think in your opening remarks, you were very clear that the proposals for new commissioners are largely with an advocacy role. And I think there is a big question to ask about why that has happened.
Yes.
Because not all of them, but most of the existing commissioners either have a regulatory or a complaints basis or whatever it might be. They are not generally on the advocacy, with one or two exceptions. And I just wonder how, in terms of trying to change the structure, whether we should be concentrating on that advocacy perspective, Because to me, and I speak personally, I think that flags up failures within the delivery of public services. And you mentioned yourself about people not feeling that their rights are being respected or sort of properly. So I just wondered if you feel that that's a line we should be looking at in more depth.
I think it would be helpful to do that. I think there's also a very, very clear, and you referred to it as well, that the proposals that are coming forward within the rights space. Now, rights and advocacy might be very closely linked. And the Scottish Human Rights Commission produced a report themselves last year about the potential expansion of the commissioner landscape in rights spaces. And I think what none of us would wish to happen would be for our national human rights institution to be hollowed out by siphoning off roles and responsibilities and powers into other parts that don't sit within our NHRI. And one of the challenges, I think, is some of the proposals that we see in the advocacy and rights spaces. Some of the proposals we see coming forward actually would give those commissioners more rights than the NHRI has currently. Yeah. And I think that's, you know, more rights, more powers. And I think that's probably something that we should all, you know, be thinking about. Why does our national human rights body not have the same powers and authority, or strong the greater powers and authorities compared to other bodies, whether they commissioners, whether they NDPBs, whatever they are, to act? There is the question around independence, and I think one of the challenges that I think one of the reasons, as well as the systemic failures that we've addressed, one of the reasons that people maybe consider that advocacy and rights-based role as being required is the independence from government, the independence from the controlling and sort of the framework setting of those public services. And I think there's a tension there that maybe comes from not only the failure to get the service, but the lack of trust that maybe those services can deliver what is needed.
And do you think that the corporate body has any views about the potential for mergers of existing roles within commissioners? I'm sure some of my colleagues will question further on this, but do you think in general there are possibilities for merging the roles of some commissioners?
Yes. And I think we probably share that across the corporate body. There's mergers or amalgamations. You know, there was that very clear suggestion in 2009. Yeah. I don't think.
And would you make that point based on the rather than on the financial basis that might save us money by doing that, or for genuine reasons that you think there's too much overlap?
I think it's about governance and accountability. I think Jackson and I probably come at this from opposite sides. Jackson very from in his finance role, and me in a more governance role. And I think there is that mutuality there. You know, if we do get a better structure of commissioners or whatever those roles turn into, if they're not office holders, does that deliver better for people? Ultimately, that's what we should be there. We should be there to ensure the finance. From my point of view, yes, it's a concern, it's a worry, but I think we do need change, because at the moment we aren't giving the commissioners necessarily the scrutiny they require across Parliament. They aren't necessarily undertaking functions in a way that meets the hopes and wishes that people established them for right at the start. So I think there is that the opportunity to restructure, to amalgamate, and I would welcome the space within Parliament to have those discussions in a comprehensive way.
Can I comment just briefly to add to Maggie by saying I certainly wouldn't begin by reverse engineering the position we have just now. Nor is it the corporate body's responsibility, I listed different advocacy commissioners that there could be. It's not our job to decide whether these are a good thing or not. But what I think the corporate body would certainly welcome, looking forward now, given what I said earlier, is Parliament establishing the architecture by which these things are properly evaluated and decides what it would like. You ask if some could be merged. Well, we've been having these conversations when we've been meeting with the existing commissioners, and the existing commissioners themselves have indicated where they think there's the potential for mergers to take place. But it might be that you establish the architecture to judge whether or not and how future commissioners are appointed, and then subsequently look again at the existing commissioners to establish whether or not they comply with whatever that architecture evolves to be after a period, but you know, when it's been properly tested.
Okay, interesting comment. I think that's a very important comment you just made. I mean, I think it comes down to this question of accountability. 2 weeks ago, we took evidence from somebody who, I was very surprised at this, had said that he had only been required to put one report before a committee. And I mean, I found that extraordinary, actually, that that was the level of accountability for that particular commissioner. And therefore, I think that in trying to restructure and ensure that we have got greater efficiency, we also have to make sure that there is greater accountability for any job that a commissioner has to this Parliament. And it's my view, again, personal, I don't think we're doing that very well just now, because I think some commissioners are really not having to go in front of a committee too often to put forward their views and to be questioned about it. And I just wondered if that's something that the SPC would agree with.
But I don't think that's a surprise. I mean, when a new cohort of MSPs is elected, as it will be in 2026, they don't come through the door beating their breasts saying, I'm looking forward to holding the commissioners to account. I mean, they come here on the back of a manifesto. They go, respective manifestos, they go into committees where they are then confronted with whatever the government's legislative programme is going to be. It may be that they want to initiate an inquiry on a particular area of policy. And then the clerks probably say to them, oh, and by the way, you're responsible for these commissioners, and you'll need to... And they probably... And with greatest respect, because I don't know that the public know all these commissioners even exist. I suspect some of the newly elected MSPs are bedazzled by the commissioners that there are, and suddenly we're responsible for them. Their first question probably isn't, what did they do? And then, you know, given that, I think probably, you know, we haven't got a proper structured way of looking at the work of commissioners. And I suspect, I don't know, you may have been in committees where you've been presented with a commissioner, it's a case of how quickly can we get through this item and on to the one that we were all more enthusiastic about discussing. Now, I'm maybe being unduly cynical when I say that, but I fear that is the level of genuine scrutiny that is currently taking place in respect of the commissioner. So I'm not altogether surprised that some have felt that they haven't been asked to present terribly much by way of information on what they do.
Which begs the question of whether we need any of them at all, but we'll leave that there.
Okay, thank you. Michelle, to follow by Joan.
Good morning. Thanks for joining us this morning. I suppose just following on from that thread, Jackson, is the public sector bold enough culturally to do what needs to be done when you bear in mind the vested interests that you set out in your earlier evidence?
Sorry, could you expand on that slightly? Just I don't want to waffle,
thinking,
so I better understand exactly what you're asking me.
Well, I often reflect back on my previous experience. If this were in the private sector and somebody new came in and said, well, frankly, I think we all agree this is a bit of a mess. You know, there's, in effect, cost overruns that you've set out. You've got a burgeoning kind of set of commissioners. They might say, even if they didn't follow it through, well, I tell you what, I'm going to get rid of them all and listen to the squeals. And so what I'm saying is the public sector bold enough in any of the component parts that we're discussing, because we realise there's different bodies, but is it fundamentally bold enough to take the steps that are really required, given what our broad agreement about the inefficiency, sometimes ineffectiveness, lack of governance, lack of scrutiny, and so on?
I don't know that the corporate body would have a view about that particularly.
I suppose
in general, I would say that there is more risk averse complacency about challenging than there has been before. I suppose I would look, for example, at the NHS and the compensation fund of the NHS. And I can recall being a health spokesman here in 2007, and I think that the compensation fund was a couple of million pounds or something. And now the compensation fund, when I last looked, it was like 53 million or something of that order. And I think that, why? Because actually it was easier to pay out compensation than it was to actually challenge what had happened and hold people to account. So I suspect, in a way, commissioners might have a role if there is a lack of boldness, as you identify, in the public sector. But I think it's also important to say that each commissioner, as we know, is created as a result of the legislative bill that has progressed in respect of that commissioner. And the Patient Safety Commissioner is a case in point where there wasn't consensus across the Parliament. There were clear divisions as that bill went through as to what the level of responsibility and authority and powers of that commissioner might be. And so I think the public might assume that the word commissioner has a common standard in respect of it, which allows them to act in a particular executive function, which might not even be the case. And I think that is also part of the difficulty going forward, that it'll be difficult to judge, I think, whether or not they have been able to execute the kind of expectations that the public had when they were appointed.
And you make that a fair comment. And I suppose what I'm also trying to explore is, when we use the term Parliament, and rightly so, I'm wondering where the leadership will come from. We'll produce a report. I'm sure it will be a good report. But what will happen out of it? And so my question to you is, where should the leadership come from? Because what we've seen here is that we've discussed with people, they've looked at their own area in a silo, in effect, and it's been quite hard to get our witnesses to step out of what their particular interest is and to look at the entire landscape, which is the landscape, the commissioner landscape, is a fundamental part of what we're trying to get make sense of. So, question, where will the leadership come from, or rather, where should it come from?
Well, I think the point I've been trying to make is I think that Parliament itself now has to take a role in that. And I mean the politicians within Parliament who are discussing these things in a transparent and open way, not the corporate body whose job it is simply to execute the will of the Parliament. And I think that we need now, to, as a Parliament, to consider what the architecture of these positions should be. In terms of the actual political execution within public services, well, the leadership for that comes from government, and they should be holding the public services to account, and politicians should be holding the government to account to ensure that those public services are held to account. I mean, that, to my mind, is the democratic route for these things to be taken forward. I mean, I've always become concerned that, you know, with this raft of commissioners, we are creating a new level of government that didn't exist when the Parliament was established. And it's not elected, and it's not properly accountable. But there is a danger that the elected representatives challenging the government are told, well, it's not our job, it's the commissioner's job to take these things forward. And we're all then wondering, well, what do we do in that regard? So I think Parliament has to understand the beast that it is creating, because it is Parliament that is creating it.
And if I can just add, I think in your question, Michelle, you talked about, you know, the siloing. People have come and spoken about their patch. I think there have been a couple of exceptions to that, and I would refer again to the Scottish Human Rights Commission review and report from last year. You know, looking at the landscape as a whole from the external, you know, non-government, non-parliament point of view, and saying this is going to cause a problem if this carries on. So there is that. There are certainly areas, maybe. Specifically within the rights and advocacy space, but there are concerns beyond this place about what the proposals that we think we might have to consider in the coming months and years will bring. And I don't think there's necessarily the antagonism to have those discussions with them on a more you know, on a broader holistic footing.
Yeah. And we had some good examples last week from Linda Towers fleshing out gaps in rights. I wanted to pick up on something that...
David.
Yeah,
no, it's quite all right. I think I would probably want to emphasise the leadership role that this committee has and has taken as well. It's difficult to see where an inquiry of this nature would sit within the existing committee structure had it not been the case that this committee had public administration added to its remit. Jackson's referred to the committee that he sat on in 2008-2009. 14, 15 years ago, that was an ad hoc committee that had to be established specially to look at these things. So without that mechanism, it's difficult to see where parliamentary scrutiny of all of this comes from and leadership comes from, other than the piecemeal scrutiny of individual office holders within the particular remits of existing committees.
Okay, thank you for that. I wanted to move on and refer to a comment that the former Deputy First Minister made some time back when, on this area, asking about the role of the SPCB. The former Deputy First Minister had previously noted that there was a ministerial control framework in terms of appointing commissioners, but she also said, and I quote, "But it could be a valid option for the SPCB to introduce best value assurance processes." I wondered if you had any thoughts on that.
So I think as Jackson has outlined already, the role, the limitations of the corporate body's role are set out by the legislation that has passed that establishes each of these commissioners, and our role comes into effect to enact the will of Parliament. It isn't a prejudging role, and I think if we were to establish that, it wouldn't be for corporate body to establish that, it would be for Parliament to establish that. It might then give those functions to corporate body, but I don't think those functions would be something that, you know, we actually don't have within our remit the ability to create that kind of assessment. I think we might have a view as to whether if such a framework were created, were we the best place to fulfil that. I think we would have views on that depending on what it was. But at the moment, we don't have the powers to create that. That would have to come to us from Parliament.
Well, it was very generous of the Deputy First Minister to consider papping the whole responsibility for this onto the corporate body. I actually don't think the corporate body is the appropriate body within Parliament to do this. I mean, we are there primarily to establish the functioning of this Parliament and the well-being of the people within it, including the MSPs. The addition of the office bearers... Well, there were two of them when the Parliament was established. I don't think it was ever really particularly envisaged that it would become this much greater responsibility that now is or could yet become. Nor do I think it's the appropriate way forward. We're not like a committee where we are on camera and these things are being openly and transparently examined. It's more of a business executive managing the estate. So I don't think that increasing the powers of the corporate body in this respect is the right route for these matters to be progressed.
Last week question then, which is, I've asked something similar before, going back to the issues over the top slice on funding and the figures that have already been quoted. Who or how could it be possible to make the budget for commissioners fixed in the way that the Scottish Parliament's budget is fixed, as a potential mechanism of controlling costs?
So one of the challenges that we've had in looking at this bit of our overall budget, about 80% of that budget is staffing costs, and as staff costs increase, therefore, you know, there's actually very little wriggle room within that because of the substantial proportion that staffing costs make up. If we were to fix that, it would, over time, result, I think, people would expect it over time to result in a reduction in the number of staff carrying out the same number of duties. Okay. You know, if, so unless there's a consequential consequential change in the duties that office holders are required to perform, and some of those duties are legislative. So, you know, unless there were changes to that, I think there would be significant challenges to that. But I don't know.
I mean, certainly in the last Parliament, we did everything we could in terms of the rationalisation of cost by bringing the commissioners, as many as we could, together. And I think we saved about £500,000 from memory in relation to the work of that. I know that additional space has become available even there, and there's the possibility of consolidating there. And that works because it allows some of the back office functions of the commissioners to be shared, you know, between the various commissioners, and that certainly saved money. One or two other commissioners are located in arrangements that had quite a long lease attached to them, so it'll be longer before some of these things can be maybe looked at again. But we are pretty rigorous. I mean, I can say that the corporate body does not roll over and say, you asked for another million, how about two? I mean, we are inclined to look and say, well, hang on a minute, you asked for another million, but can you explain more widely why? And we have gone back and declined requests that have arisen. But it's also the case that some of these bodies, commissioners, have had additional responsibilities levelled on them, which actually do have a consequent requirement for additional staff in order for those to be fulfilled. And I come back to the fact that the corporate body's responsibility is to ensure that the office holders who have been established by the will of Parliament are adequately resourced in order to undertake those functions. So a fixed budget would be a difficult thing, I think, to apply, given that even as we speak, there are additional responsibilities being attached to some of the commissioners that we currently have, which will carry with them additional burdens that they will have to, with which they will have to cope.
I would just add the £500,000 that Jackson referred to is protected savings over a 10-year period from 2020, but we're actually performing better than that as we stand. So the projection there will be that we'll comfortably meet that target and exceed it. My colleagues are right that the corporate body spends a lot of time bearing down on additional costs. And one example of that is where costs rise in year. We handle that through a centrally held contingency budget. Office holders can make a call on that, but we don't issue that money until it's clear that they can't meet those additional costs from their existing budget. So that will happen towards the end of a financial year. And it also ensures that those additional costs don't become baselined into their routine budgets, that they're held in that way so that they're dealt with properly as an ad hoc expense and not kind of surreptitiously added to baseline budgets.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. John, followed by Patrick.
Hey, thanks so much, Convener. I mean, I'm struggling to work out in my head a tidy way ahead with all this and where it can go that's going to be neat and please people and all the rest of it. But I suppose I do lean towards the idea of the Scottish Human Rights Commission being given more powers, and this idea that's been suggested to us of a kind of rapporteur or lead model, so that somebody would lead on children, somebody would lead on animals, somebody would lead on older people, that kind of thing. Which I've had a little bit of experience with rapporteurs at the UN level, and they seem to be pretty effective, and they write reports, and that has quite an impact. I mean, from your perspective as the corporate body, would that model be easier to work with? That you, instead of dealing with all these commissioners, you would just be dealing with an enlarged SHRC?
I mean, in terms of the corporate body's responsibilities around funding and governance, yes, you know, it will be easier. It would be easier to deal with one than several. I think that's a pretty clear line. I think we have an interest in, if no responsibility for, scrutinising the functions, and I think that they would need to, alongside any changes that corporate body would have to make, there would need to be consequential changes in how committees functioned and dealt with the functional scrutiny role. And I think one of the challenges would be to ensure that, you know, as Jackson has said, we are not convinced that it happens in as robust a format now, how would that change, or what would be put at risk, or what could be improved with that different model? But I think in terms of a reduction in number, I think necessarily it would make it easier in one way, in terms of funding lines, in terms of the budget asks. We might have slightly different questions to ask to understand how those different elements, the different rapporteurs within that fit together to ensure. But from a functional point of view, those questions would probably better sit with committees.
I mean, I think the fear was that some issues would get lost, like autism, say, would just get lost in some huge human rights commission. But that's maybe less of a question for yourselves than it would be for the committees.
I don't know that would necessarily follow. And I think there's some sympathy for the suggestion that you make from within the current architecture of commissioners, who I think are potentially concerned that clear lines of responsibility and authority are potentially being diluted with the additional advocacy commissioners, because where then does the rights commissioner sit within that? And could it not have been that would have been a better way forward? But of course, that's not something, because I come right back to the early point about the architecture and the way these things are established, that's not how it comes about. It comes about because an organisation enhances the support of an MSP who comes forward with a proposal for a bill to create a commissioner, and the kind of suggestion that it fit in within an existing structure isn't really anything that you could move a bill about. I mean, it wouldn't be it doesn't fit in with the current structural arrangement. So I think that's what Parliament has to get right first, and then judge where these things go in terms of how they go forward. And it may well be, Mr. Mason, that we will go from Royal Commission to Summit to Conference to Tsar to Commissioner to we all want a rapporteur for our particular cause. I don't know. But if the architecture is more robust around all of that, then I think that would be more reassuring.
Yes, and I mean, my understanding of the rapporteur model would be that somebody might be appointed for, say, 5 years, so there could be an emphasis on children for 5 years and then perhaps an emphasis on older people at another point. Because the idea of freezing, and that I think Liz Smith was suggesting, that we kind of somehow freeze the system so the unfairness of it at present carries on, but at least we stop more unfairness coming in. Because, I mean, we had Age Scotland and others saying, well, if children need a commissioner, older people need a commissioner. Although it has to be said, older people do have a vote. So I'm kind of reluctant to go down that route, but I'll not ask you.
Well, I think I suggested more of a phased approach, that I wouldn't reverse engineer as the first step, but I certainly would, in any structure I created, have it understood that at some point the existing structure, the existing appointed office holders would be accommodated and required to fit within that structure, but it wouldn't be my starting point.
Fair enough. Now, we looked at scrutiny, and the committees are meant to be scrutinising a commissioner. At the moment, there's seven, but of course, there's more outside bodies. So I think the Economy Committee would be scrutinising the Scottish National Investment Bank. I think we scrutinise the Scottish Fiscal Commission, although technically it's not a commission for these purposes. It's not just that every committee's got one or two. There are already quite a landscape out there. I mean, on that point, does it really make a difference if something's called a commission or a commissioner? I think for the children, it's a commissioner rather than a commission. Does it matter if it's a government commission, like the police, Inspector of Constabulary, is it? And the Inspector of Prisons, they're government commissions, whereas we've got Parliament ones. I mean, from your point of view, it would make a difference, and you wouldn't scrutinise them, but do you think it makes a difference in practice?
I think what the view of the corporate body would be that we recognise that there are these different models. You mentioned police, prisons. You know, there are inspectorates that maybe fulfil some of the role that commissioners or some of the commissioners might in part fulfil. In terms of the difference it would make to us, we don't have any role or responsibility around the inspectorates that you've mentioned. Scottish National Investment Bank, anything like that. Our role is, once a commissioner, once an office holder is identified and created, then our role kicks in. So there are clearly other models. There are clearly other models where the government retains that responsibility, or the government has that establishment of that body and has responsibility. And then committees engage, scrutinise as they see fit.
So the budget's coming from a different place. I mean, do we know if it's almost a parallel process, that just as the commissioner comes to you and asks for a budget, the other commissioners go to the government and ask for a budget? Presumably that's what happens.
Well, the functions will still have to be financially backed, but I don't think the corporate body has information on whether the budget would be significantly different if it was handled separately rather than through the corporate body's budget.
I mean, we've referred back to previous recommendations and the committee that you were on, Mr. Carlaw, and I think the Finance Committee in 2006. They seem to be fairly clear recommendations that were made at that time, 2006, 8, 9, whatever. Why do you think they've been ignored?
Well, you're asking me then to draw on nearly 50 years of involvement in politics and life. And the common thread, I would say, in everything where I've been on the ground floor of any decision that has been made, is that the people who make it move on and other people come in behind them, and then they're succeeded by other people again. And those people who understood the what, why, where and when have disappeared, and the agenda of the people who subsequently are there is different. And so I think there are lots of things in public life that any one of us might have been involved in ourselves, where we then look to see what they're doing now and we think, well, that's very different to anything that was going on when I was involved in it. And I'm not actually sure I think that's why it was there or what it was there to do. So I think that's just the natural process. This isn't a fixed body, the Parliament. It's a body of parliamentarians. And, you know, as I think I've observed before, I think we had 50 new parliamentarians in 2016 and 40 new parliamentarians in 2021. Of the 129 MSPs, none of them, you know, very few of them were here. The number who were here when the Parliament was created and any of these decisions were taken, even in 2006 or 2008, is very few. And I don't think people are reminded of the institutional memory of Parliament, particularly in any respect whatsoever. Everybody just lives in their current stream and operates within it, and that's how we function. And it's not to be recommended, but it is as it is.
I suppose it is democracy. But so, I mean, if we don't legislate by 2026, basically whatever this committee decides is going to be forgotten about.
Well, I would hope not, because, I mean, there is a characteristic history of legacy reports from one parliament to the next, and, you know, those legacy reports forming the basis of understanding as to how Parliament will proceed. And I don't think there's any political ill will on this. It's that nobody has actually thought about it, and that the kind of control that there was previously, which was of government very reluctant to, you know, to facilitate any, has changed, and therefore I think if there is an agreed architecture, I think most MSPs in a future parliament would be quite happy to operate within whatever that architecture was. That's my own view. Okay.
Hopefully. And finally, I think, I understand the Public Petitions Committee has been looking at the SPSO and the possibility of a review. And the suggestion was made the government wasn't particularly keen on a review. Should it be the government that reviews all of these bodies, or should it be someone else?
As convener of the Public Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee, I can say yes, that we did have a petition come forward where the petitioner was seeking a review of the Scottish Public Service Ombudsman, because within the articles establishing that office was the establishment that there would be a review. I think we were quite surprised that the Scottish Government acknowledges that, but then doesn't want to have one. And rather embarrassingly, I think the Ombudsman's come back saying she would welcome a review. So it comes to the issue of transparency, even within the existing architecture that we've got, that here is an office. I think the I should say the objectives of the petitioner and the objectives of the Ombudsman herself in relation to what that review might be achieved might be very, very different. But nonetheless, I think it points again to this kind of reluctance to look in detail at what we have created and how it is functioning. If it was envisaged that a review should take place, well, then a review should.
Thank you, Convener.
You, Patrick, to follow by Jamie.
Convener, good morning. It seems to me, and a few of you have spoken about this already, that we're using the term commissioner to mean very different things. You know, we've got significant functions being carried out on an ongoing basis, like the Information Commissioner, that clearly needs to be a public body with serious resources, and most people would think it would be inappropriate for that to be part of the government. You've got other areas where it might be a piece of policy work that would be happening within government anyway, and it's just about carrying that out in a separate way, perhaps beyond the Scottish Government and bringing in the wider public sector. And then, as Jackson has described on a couple of occasions, you've got this kind of slightly more amorphous space of advocacy in which the call for a commissioner lands in much the same way as a call for various other kinds of interventions that elevate the status of an issue. And it does seem to me that that's an entirely legitimate thing for people to advocate for. It's actually quite consistent with the notion that we had 25 years ago that this would be a parliament that shares power with the people, whether that's through citizens' assemblies that have been tried a few times, whether that's through the older idea of a civic forum, which wasn't brilliant, but it was abolished instead of being improved. There are various ways for that to happen, and the creation of commissioners is a legitimate way of filling that space. But if there's a worry that it proliferates and costs too much, I wonder if the thing to do, rather than closing that down, is to give it its space, but in a lighter touch way, you know, something like the difference between an ambassador and an honorary consul. The corporate body gives committees resources at the moment to appoint committee advisors on a particular issue. Isn't there a space for something with a bit more status than that, you know, Parliament's advisor on a particular issue that can perform some of that advocacy role, help to bring marginalised voices in, but without needing to be a public body in its own right? A person who would undertake that role and have a degree of status with Parliament directly, but without having to create this kind of big range of new public bodies that need constant resourcing. And then within each session of Parliament, perhaps the corporate body might even decide to cap the amount of money that it would provide for Parliament to appoint such people, and each new session of Parliament would start with a clean slate. Is that one way of giving some legitimate space to this very reasonable argument for a connection with civic society and a role for advocacy, but without necessarily all of the baggage?
Well, I think, again, Maggie, it's not something the corporate body has discussed, but I have to say I think the idea as you articulated is actually a very interesting one, and does create the advocacy opportunity that you identify, but perhaps with a beginning and a middle and an end in terms of a clear accountability through a committee structure. So, I mean, I think it's a very interesting alternative way of potentially considering how these advocacy functions might be taken forward. Yes.
Thank you. That was easy.
Was that you? My God, I thought you'd been asking questions for a good 10 minutes yet, Patrick. Clearly you're new to this committee. Jamie, to follow by Michael.
Thanks very much. Morning to the panel. I suppose one of the questions I was actually going to ask is similar along those lines. I mean, we talk a lot, there's been a lot of talk about Parliament and how Parliament itself functions, and taking that and also the kind of role of committees and how they function. I suppose, kind of following on from what Patrick Harvey's just been saying, do you think as part of that any reform of Parliament, we should be looking at committees that perhaps have more teeth to be able to hold government to account on some of these advocacy issues, perhaps, that they've not been able to, perhaps, in the past?
I'm tempted to say you're inviting us to rush in where angels fear to tread. I'm not entirely sure that it's the corporate body's responsibility to consider whether that would be the appropriate thing to do. I mean, I think these are issues of reform which are being more widely considered by parliamentarians generally. I hesitate for Maggie and I to identify what the alternative architecture for committee accountability and authority would be. But Maggie may be happy to rush in where I, as an angel, fear to tread.
I suppose, and in part answer to Patrick's earlier question as well, I think I come back to why corporate bodies are concerned with the situation we currently have. And yes, it's about burgeoning costs or potential burgeoning costs, but it is that role of accountability about actually why are these bodies set up? Why are they established? What is the underlying cause for that? And is addressing that cause better done in another way? Whether, you know, having somebody advising specifically in committee, whether it's giving committees additional responsibilities and powers, whether it's having different lines of accountability and redress within existing public service structures and how they relate to government. I think we need to look at those, but it's not necessarily for corporate body. Well, it isn't for corporate body to say this is what we should do. I think it's for us, as we are doing here this morning, to say these are our concerns. This is where we see this going if we don't do anything about it. And these are the consequences: financial consequences, consequences of accountability, consequences also of disappointment and disillusionment, and the failure of, you know, breaking even further of trust. Because if the commissioners don't sort out the problems that people think they're going to sort out, well, people aren't going to trust commissioners then. And there is a legitimate role and a very important role, as we've outlined, you know, around regulatory, around complaints, and I would argue around some rights and advocacy issues. If the whole suite is brought into doubt or question because they don't achieve what they are set out to achieve, that doesn't work. That's not good for any of this.
Okay, thanks, Frank. Well, we've avoided the controversial split.
Well, I was going to make just one point, which I think is there was a missed opportunity in this regard, in that I was invited to serve on the previous Presiding Officer's Commission on Parliamentary Reform. With hindsight, this could have been part of its remit, and it wasn't. And I think with hindsight now, particularly with the potential proliferation, perhaps it should have been something that Commission had a look at as well, because it's becoming, I think, a bigger issue for Parliament.
Thank you, that's very helpful. Can I focus a little bit on some of the kind of areas that have been covered before? You talked about, I think, Maggie, you talked about the kind of oversight and the scrutiny role, but it's very much just on the governance, and that there is an assessor that keeps an eye on that. But do you have any oversight in terms of committees calling in commissioners? So would you be able to say, well, we know that all committees have called in and taken evidence from interviewed the commissioners, they are supposed to, as part of their remit?
So we can certainly ask for that information, but there's no power to compel. I think one of the reasons we established the agreement between committees and corporate body, the conveners group and corporate body last year, was to address some of these issues, to open up a line of communication that had maybe not been as effective as it might have been in the past, to also support committees to understand where the different responsibilities lay, what were corporate bodies' responsibilities and what were their responsibilities. And I think, as Jackson said initially, you know, there probably aren't many MSPs who come in wanting to scrutinise the work and the functions of a commissioner or a commission. And understanding that those are the responsibilities, you know, that there are committee responsibilities there, comes maybe not as a shock or a surprise, but, you know, people just were not aware. So that agreement was an attempt to try and strengthen that. I think, as Jackson outlined, from our point of view, we have changed the way we call in commissioners and commissions on at least an annual basis to hear about issues, and that's separate to the budget scrutiny and the annual report stuff that we will do. So there are mechanisms to do that. Does corporate body routinely get told when committees are calling office holders in? No. Can we ask? Yes. I don't think there's any, but there's no obligation on committees to let corporate body know that this is what they've done this year.
I mean, I think John Mason made the point. The committees have a number of organisations that they have to hold to account. We have legislation, et cetera, to run through. Yeah. And there is somewhat of a feeling sometimes with some of these commissioners, well, we need to get them in, or we have to get them in, or we should get them in. And that's concerning in regards to scrutiny, because it feels like it's a kind of secondary importance despite the kind of huge amounts of money that are involved, or increasing amounts of money that are involved. I suppose a kind of perhaps a difficult question, but the whole point of commissioners surely is to deliver a solution to a problem. Now, they may not always deliver that solution, and they may not always identify the right problem, but we're spending just over 18 million pounds on it. You know, do you feel we're getting value for money from that? And do you think we're getting value for money in terms of the outcomes? Or is that a difficult one to ask?
I think we've already discussed the range of roles that commissioners have. You know, the regulatory commissioners have very, very particular roles. Complaints handling commissioners, likewise. You know, I think there are questions that probably many of us might have. Are we getting value for money out of the Electoral Commission, for instance? You know, but the answers to that aren't necessarily ours to give. In terms of what we try to do, or what we are tasked with doing in corporate body, is ensuring that there is compliance around the governance, around employment, around accountable officer, those kinds of things, ensuring that there is compliance for that, ensuring that we understand what it is that commissioners are trying to achieve, and therefore what resources they require to do that, and trying as best we can, without just giving them what they want, without question, but to give them the resources to fulfil those roles. In terms of the outcomes and operational functionality, I think that would be a question for the scrutiny committees that have, you know, do those committees think that office holders and commissioners are delivering what they were intended to deliver? I think that there's a clear joint responsibility there between corporate body and committees to answer that question.
Okay. I think that's a fair assessment by Maggie. It's not for the corporate body to judge these things. I think my own enthusiasm for these things is palpable in that I'm lukewarm as to what it is we have created. I've referred to the beast that is growing as a completely unelected level of government, and I'm not sure that we can... I mean, if you were to ask the average, you were to ask any MSP to give a five-minute talk on the outcomes achieved by the commissioner landscape in Scotland, I don't think it would be very informed.
And I think what's probably more concerning on that is that if you ask them to speak about commissioners, that their committees that they sit on are responsibility, that might be the same difficulty.
Well, I mean, don't be wrong, some of these things are required. You know, it's not that, and we've distinguished between the different operations that we have. And I think it's important to say that it's not, we talk about commissioners, in some cases it's a commission, a commission full of commissioners. So even the language in terms of what people, the office that people occupy is not equal.
Yeah. Thank you.
The written agreement that we've referred to a few times tries to clarify the respective roles of the corporate body and the parliamentary committees, but one of the things it doesn't do is set out which committee remits are engaged by each of the office holders, and I think there's probably a bit more work could be done on that regard, and hopefully that would prompt those committees to be more active in the area in which their remit is engaged.
I think it's helpful, David. Who would you suggest does that work, though?
That's something that could be done at an official level, at an administrative level. I'd be quite happy to take that forward.
Okay. Thank you.
Michael.
Can I just continue in the same vein for a short period, if that's okay? This idea of kind of assessing the outcomes. I mean, Jamie Halkrow-Johnson says that, or perhaps it was yourself, Jackson, sorry, that the MSPs would not be able to describe the activities of or the outcomes of a commissioner. It seems from the evidence that we've gathered that the commissioners aren't particularly able to describe the outcomes of what the commissioners do either, and neither are some of the advocates who are asking for new commissioners. So there is, I mean, this relationship between outcomes and the commissioners, I think, is a slightly vexed one in terms of the work that we've done. But your point earlier about transparency, I mean, there's no real, in my view, or the transparent, vigorous holding to account for outcomes of commissioners, is there? When they come to you and ask for budget, you're telling us that you don't drill into what have you done with the money that you've been given. But are you saying that that should happen in other committees but just doesn't?
Yes, I think that would be the case. I mean, our responsibility, I mean, these are largely requirements for additional staff to exercise functions. In some cases, it can actually be that the work of the commissioner has become better known, and that's prompted far more public inquiries of that commissioner, and those inquiries then thereafter have to be tackled. It could be that they've been given additional responsibilities by government and they therefore have to have the resource in place to tackle those responsibilities. But in terms of the outcomes to public benefit, the corporate body would take the view that's very much the responsibility of the subject committees to take forward. Our responsibility is to ensure that the housekeeping within the actual commission is effective that is a good use of public money, and that public money is being carefully managed.
I would say in addition to that, I think there is maybe also a distinction between how we view our role between the different types of commissioners as well. So, for instance, you know, in some of the complaints handling commissioners, where we are seeing, and they report to us, a significant increase in complaints and the lack of resources to deal with those complaints in a timely way, we would then say, well, you know, what is it you need? How can we make this work within budget? Do you need to draw on the contingency budget that David mentioned earlier? And so in terms of outcomes, there's a numbers tracking that we have done, and we have done in quite some considerable detail with the complaints handling commissioners. But I think that is of quite a different quality to the outcomes that you might expect would be delivered by the Scottish Human Rights Commission or the Children and Young People's Commission, for example.
I suppose that's probably stood up certainly by evidence we've had from the Freedom of Information Commissioner, who's told us, you know, that essentially he has to deal with complaints, and it depends on how many complaints
he
gets.
Game.
It's not really up to him in that regard. Okay, so we've also, I think, as we've gone through this, looking at the kind of almost a taxonomy of the different forms of commissioners, and, you know, and at the start of this, rejecting the word because it's pretty useless, doesn't really describe because it's so diverse, as John Mason pointed out earlier on, and that there is, I think we focus quite a lot today on these issues of advocacy and rights-based areas. We also have technical commissioners, in essence, I would say, so one in particular, in the biometrics commissioner. And so Dr. Brian Plasto gave us some evidence on the 30th of April, if I can give you a quote from that. He said, "I've been in post for 3 years. I've been called before the committee once in 3 years, and that was to discuss the passing of the Statutory Code of Practice back in 2022. In those 3 years, I've submitted 7 reports to Parliament, 2 annual reports and accounts, 1 operational report, a code of practice, and 3 separate assurance reviews. My expectation would have been to have been called before the Criminal Justice Committee more often than I have been." Any reflections on whether this is fit for purpose?
I think we would agree with them. I think we would agree with them. And it's interesting because I think the Biometrics Commissioner is one, and I put this to the Biometrics Commissioner. Should the public know he exists, or is his function to ensure that the responsibilities that he has are properly executed? And in many respects, it's the latter. His is not a responsibility that needs to be advertised in the press as you've got the biometrics commissioner rush off to speak to. His function is to analyse what is going on and ensure that it is correct in the way that it is being implemented and that people's rights are being properly respected. And I suppose that would draw me to the point that I think we've been pretty fortunate that the individuals that we've managed to appoint to be commissioners have, by and large, in my experience, all been deeply impressive and committed individuals. And we've been fortunate in the absence of proper scrutiny that that is the case. On the one occasion where it proved not to be, I think the lack of scrutiny exposed the weaknesses of our arrangements. And to some extent, I think, you know, Parliament, both the corporate body and others, have been, you know, considering what the ramifications of all of that are in terms of our overall operation. You know, we can't just rely upon the goodwill and good management of individuals. Parliament, if it's created these operational structures, really has got a duty to put in place a much more robust form of scrutiny.
I suppose I'm pointing at this technical expertise level as well, because I see in my mind there's a distinction where Parliament is establishing a commissioner to deal with something that we would not necessarily have the technical expertise to deal with, but which is required in order to analyse this. For instance, I could quite easily see this being subsequently being a commissioner for artificial intelligence in the public domain, and understanding where closed algorithms are used within public services and how that relates to public policy, and being a time-limited group of things that we can't do. But also there's a question there about whether we have the technical capacity to scrutinise.
I think that's a fair point, and that's why I think that Parliament has to decide and design what the architecture of all of this should be, and by a deliberate act of policy, identify the very point you make and thereby decide if that type of commissioner is created, what is the accountability route that should exist. At the moment, I think everything is simply consequential on a commissioner being appointed without there having been given proper thought before it was created as to what the Commission would do or how it would be properly held to account.
I think that's right. And I think there needs to be differences in what accountability even means, as you say, because it's not possible for 129 MSPs to have the technical expertise necessary for some of these. But I think it is possible for 129 MSPs to understand what rights realisation outcomes look like. So you know, there would be very, very different routes through and requirements for accountability in that different architecture.
And in giving that quote, I'm not being critical of the Criminal Justice Committee. Mm-hmm. I think we'd all recognise the scale of the legislative burden they've got in front of them at the moment. But in a similar way, we're looking at whether it be the Patients' Rights Commissioner. I mean, if they were scrutinising the performance of that commissioner, the budget is likely to be £2 million, roughly, maybe, a little bit less. Whereas they might have somebody in front of them from the NHS talking about £22 billion. And there's a question in terms of the level of function that a committee should give as proportion to the scale of the public purse. I think there will be some people who would be asking the question of the Finance Committee, why are we so concerned about £18 million when we have a budget of £30 billion, you know, and for various parts of the public services that we should be scrutinising? It's a small proportion of the overall budget.
I suppose there are a couple of different points in that. Overall, £18.2 million isn't a large proportion of the overall budget that we're looking at. But the expectation on members of the public for these bodies to deliver for them, I think that's actually what is of interest to us. Not, you know, the resources enable them to do that, but it's that task that should be of primary interest. And when there are those disparities in resource, you know, can I think, David, did you say 640,000 is the expected budget for the Patient Safety Commissioner? What does that mean that that office will be able to do in comparison to some of the similar mechanisms that might already exist within the NHS with all of the financial and institutional backing that has? So I think there are legitimate questions around those issues.
Important to say 640,000 at inception. I mean, my experience of 8 years in the corporate body is no commissioner has ever come to me and said, I think I could cut my budget in half. They have always come saying that the demand, and I can see the Patient Safety Commissioner being a case in point, the demand is such that I now need to expand. And effectively what they mean by that is additional staff, and it's very easy to see how that budget can multiply quickly.
Okay. Thank you. And my last area was in relation to the relationship between the politics of this and the process in the Parliament. I suppose listening to you this morning in terms of what mechanisms, and we're all keen to know, might be put in place. Part of this is that we all arrive here with manifestos, as highlighted by Mr. Carlaw, some of which will say we will have commissioners because the people writing those manifestos have listened to third sector organisations who are campaigning for. Would you, as the corporate body, consider writing to the party leaders, setting out some of your concerns to them ahead of a manifesto process for 2026, to state to them, actually, should you be approached by bodies out with the Parliament, you know, if you come with a manifesto, this is the problems that it's going to present?
Well, I think I would very much welcome this committee taking a lead in that regard, which the corporate body, I'm sure, would be very happy to endorse.
And I think, in, you know, when these discussions in this session started a couple of years ago, I think we did discuss on corporate body, you know, how is it best to start these conversations? Is it through mechanisms such as you outline letters to party leaders? Is it through direct approaches to committees? Is it to consider, is it direct approaches to members who are proposing commissioners or who are backing proposals for commissioners? And again, because the way in which our responsibilities currently are outlined, they are post-event. Okay. And I think it's that pre-event, which is the politics of it, as you say. And corporate body is, I think we do a pretty good job at not engaging in those kinds of discussions.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Just one final question for me, and it's regarding the existing commissioner landscape. And we obviously took evidence from some commissioners, and there seemed to be a kind of drawbridge kind of mentality whereby our commission's great. Actually, in fact, we need more resources and more powers, but we don't really think there should be any more, so we'll pull the drawbridge up behind us. I mean, so there's an element of tension, I think, between the commissioners themselves and certainly in terms of new commissioners. I mean, we talked, for example, about rapporteurs for the Scottish Human Rights Commission, but how clear are you on the efficiency and effectiveness of the delivery of its remit that there is within the Scottish Human Rights Commission now? Do you feel that they're in a position that they could actually do that? Should resources be made available, or do you think that they really have to do more to ensure that they're a more effective and efficient delivery of what they're already responsible for?
I mean, I suppose two points I'd make on that. Firstly, within the corporate body, we've had conversations with the Scottish Human Rights Commission around the level of resourcing, the expected additional resources that they consider might be necessary should potentially proposed legislation go through this Parliament. In terms of what that would mean, I think we've received requests for additional resources. We've knocked some of those back, and we've granted some of those, or granted in part some of those, depending what's going on. If there were a change in structure and responsibilities for the Scottish Human Rights Commission with a rapporteur or similar model, I think it would be a fair expectation that there would need to be either you know, a shifting, a redesigning of how their resources are allocated. If some of those additional people, rapporteurs, came with powers and additional functions, I think it would be
delivering at the moment? Do you feel they're delivering what they're responsible for at the moment efficiently and effectively? Is that a view that the SPCB has? Because if we're talking about them becoming the core in the future, it's interesting to look at where we are at present in terms of what they are actually delivering.
I think they have done. I think overall my assessment would be yes. They are delivering on what they need to do, but they want to, and I think we in this place might wish them to do more, and they cannot do that more necessarily without additional support. I think there is also a question in this that isn't for corporate body and is probably better addressed to the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee that does scrutinise the Scottish Human Rights Commission. I sit as deputy convener of that committee, and we do have regular conversations with that, but that's beyond the corporate body's remit.
Okay. Possibly less sanguine, in as much it's important to remember that most, if not all, of the commissioners are part-time. They're not full-time. The human rights has gone through quite a challenging period. And I think the common feature, I would say, over the last few years is where any additional responsibilities are allocated. It's quite a milestone within that organisation. So in the event that the architecture was deliberately put in place with a proper design as to how things might operate, I think there would have to be a phased introduction of that over a timeline. I don't think if we were to say, you know, that from January 2025 you're going to be doing this, I don't think that would work. And in some cases, particularly if you were talking about rapporteurs and a much expanded Commission for Human Rights, it may well be that, you know, some of the part-time nature of all of that would have to be reviewed because it would be a much larger and more important function. So to my mind, I don't think it would be safe to say that you could simply at the moment move from where we are to where we might be by allocating responsibility immediately to the existing infrastructure. I'm not sure it would cope.
See, you're taking a fifth there, David. Thanks very much for your evidence today. Just before we wind up, I just want to give you an opportunity, if there's any final points you feel that we haven't covered or that you're desperate to convey to the committee.
I think you've probably exhausted the potential to draw the experience and views of the corporate body out any further, and I'm very grateful to you for our opportunity, particularly given that I think your inquiry arose out of an initial approach to you through the finance process of the budget to have such a committee, such an inquiry. So we very, very much welcome the fact that this is taking place, and I don't know how else it would have happened had it not. And I think it's taking place in time for a proper conclusion to be reached, which could have implications for the next session of Parliament. And I very much hope that's the case.
Okay, thank you, Maggie. Or David, anything further to add?
Just to reiterate Jackson's comments, and thank you for taking this issue up, because it does exercise us in corporate body around, you know, our ability to provide the resources and the governance support that is required, not only in terms of corporate body itself, but the officers that provide the ongoing, you know, routine, sometimes daily, more often weekly or monthly support for the different office holders. And I think that there are questions for us around how sustainable the current system would be if we keep adding office holders in. So, yeah, it's a thank you from me.
Mm-hmm. Thanks for that.
I don't have anything to add, Convener. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that. We will continue taking evidence next week from the Cabinet Secretary for Finance. So watch this space. So thank you very much for answering our questions, and thank you for colleagues for their questions this morning. We now go into private session to allow our witnesses and official report to leave. We'll take a 5-minute break. Thank you.